Genesis 28, if you have your copy of God's Word, go ahead and open it up there. Genesis, the 28th chapter, and I don't say this often, but I want you to know that today's sermon has the potential of being one of the most important sermons that you will ever hear. Not because I'm preaching it, but because of the truth, the life-altering, life-changing truth that's contained in this sermon. It literally can change the course of your life if you'll really get it. So give it a fair hearing. And ask God as I preach what he's trying to say to you, and just look out for what's coming. It's going to be a life-changing moment for some of you. Let me make mention before I get started this morning that tonight we're going to have our Low Country Boil. Now, that's how we celebrate Thanksgiving on Amelia Island. We boil shrimp, all right? Turkeys are safe around here. We eat the shrimp. So tonight, I want to invite every one of you to come on out, bring a friend, go get your neighborhood and your workplace, and just bring them all out. We're prepared for a great crowd tonight. And then following that service at 5, that's going to be our Low Country Boil at 5 o'clock. And then following that service, we're going to have our Third at First service. Now, that's where we are test driving a new form of kind of how we do, the mode of how we do our worship service in a more contemporary format. And the goal is, the last Sunday of January, we're going to launch a new service in the morning. And so we'll give you more details as that approaches, but make plans to be here tonight just to see what that's all about and how it feels in that environment, creating an environment for people who are really far from the Lord to come to know him. But the sermon tonight, We're teaching out of the Song of Solomon, and tonight we're talking primarily about conflict in marriage. Now, some of you just elbowed your partner right there because you know if you ever needed a sermon, you need a sermon on conflict in marriage. So I want to invite you tonight to be there as we continue this study of the Old Testament book, the Song of Solomon. So today we're in Genesis 28, and I want you to imagine with me, just pretend you were at a party, and at the party, someone gave you one of those little stickers to put on your chest that looked something like this, and it just says, "Hello, I am," and typically, you would write your name in that blank. But suppose the person who's handing out the stickers, who's welcoming you to the party, said, "We're going to play a little game to help everybody get to know each other. And instead of writing your name, I want you to write a description of who you are other than your name that would help someone get to know you better." Now, studies show that probably somewhere around 90% of us would write our occupation. We write what we do. "Hello, I am a teacher. I am a business owner. I am a salesperson," whatever it might be. That's how we typically would identify ourselves and communicate to others how they can know a little bit about us. Some people might would write their political affiliation. "I'm a Democrat," or "I am a Republican." Others may write their worldview. "I'm a conservative," or "I'm a liberal." Some would write the city that they're from. "I'm from Jacksonville," or if you're like me, you're from a small town that's so small that you always talk about the next closest town to it. So if somebody said, "Well, Zach, where are you from?" I've told many of you, "I'm from Huntsville, Alabama." Well, that's technically a lie. "I'm from Dimbo Holler." Now, I know a lot of people brag about being from Dimbo Holler, but I'm the real deal, all right? Now, "I'm from Dimbo Holler, Alabama," but you wouldn't know where that's at, so I say I'm from Huntsville. But now, I didn't know when I started thinking through Florida and South Georgia, what is the Dimbo Holler of Florida? And I started researching a little bit, and I found that in Brooksville, Florida, there is a town called Wickiwatchee. Anybody here this morning from Wickiwatchee, Florida? Anybody? You wouldn't tell us if you were, would you? Just north of Merritt Island, there's a city called Possum Bluff, Florida. West of Cocoa Beach, there's a lone cabbage. Just above Tallahassee, there's Two Egg, Florida. I don't know why they called it Two Egg, Florida. And my favorite was just west of Vero Beach is Yeehaw Junction. Now, you always know a fellow from Yeehaw Junction. You know, that's just a good name for a city. You might write where you're from. You might write your experience, something you've been through, maybe a tragedy. Maybe you would write, I'm a widow, or I'm homeless. Still others might write their struggles. I'm an alcoholic, an addict. Others might write their accomplishments. I'm a college graduate. I'm an athlete. But still others would write something that someone placed on them. And one of the most identifying things that can happen to someone is something that they heard early and often. Now, throughout this series, we're going to revisit early and often. Parents have a very high influence over the identity of their children. But there's something at the core of your being that affects who you are, and it's sort of the sun in the solar system or the hub in the wheel. I think we have an image to just kind of show you the idea of a wheel, and that center hub is the identity, and all of the other spokes go out from that. What is at the hub of your life? What is the core thing that identifies you above all else? One of the mega themes of the scriptures is that God wants your ultimate identity, how you think of yourself and how you present yourself, to be founded as who you are in Christ. And then every other aspect of your life to come off of that. So if you are a salesperson, you're a Christian first and then you're a salesperson. Or if you're a Republican, you're a Christian first, then a Republican. Or if you're a widow, you're a Christian first, and then you're a widow. So all of those things come out of your core identity. And when I use the word identity, I'm talking about that most core part of you, the truest thing about you, from which all other aspects come forth. Proverbs 23, verse 7, Solomon said, "As a man thinks within his heart, so is he." Zig Ziglar, the motivational speaker, said, "It is impossible for a person to perform in a way that is inconsistent with how they see themselves." So how you think of yourself, the truest thing about you, your core identity, is going to have massive influence over how you live your life. And it's impossible for you to consistently perform in a way that is inconsistent with how you see yourself. You say, "Pastor, how do I know how to identify that core part of me? How do I know what is the truest thing about me?" Maybe think about these questions. What do you get angry about most? What do you celebrate most? What do you seek to replicate most? Here's a good one. What will you sacrifice for? What do you worry about? What keeps you awake at night? Those kind of questions kind of reveal what that hub is in the center of your heart. I tell you, the most revealing place to know what a person's core identity is, sadly, is at their funeral. Because at that point, there's not a lot they can do about it. I'll never forget preaching a funeral up in central Kentucky, and it was a funeral for a family. The man didn't attend our church, but I had a friendship with the guy who ran the funeral home. And I told him, I said, "Look, if someone needs a pastor to preach the funeral and they don't have somebody, then I would be honored to be a part of that." And so he called me one day and he said, "I've got a family. They don't have all the kids are from out of town. They would love someone to come help them with this funeral." I said, "I'd be happy to." So I drove down and I'm interviewing the family, getting to know them a little bit. And so I asked one of the kids, "Tell me about your father who just passed away." And these adult children began to kind of, you know, try to describe their father some. And I said, "Well, let me ask you a question. What was his faith like? Did you talk any about his faith experience or his journey of faith or anything like that. And everybody kind of looked at one another. Nobody really had anything to say. And then one of the girls said, well, we never got around to talking about that very much. But I'll tell you what, Daddy loved NASCAR. He was all about NASCAR. Then everybody began to chime in and talk about how much Dad loved NASCAR. Why? That was his core. That was the hub of his life. Now, everywhere else he went, everything else he did, he was first and foremost a NASCAR fan. And everything about him flowed out of that core identity, and it came out very vividly once he was gone. And yours will as well. Whatever your core identity is, chances are, if you don't have a clue what it is, ask your children. Ask your spouse. Ask your work associates. What is the core in my life that trumps everything else that I interact with? Your identity. God wants your identity, the truest thing about you, to be who you are in Christ. And everything you're experiencing in life is to get you to that point. So the difficulties, the victories, everything you're experiencing is to get you to the point that you will realize that He is the King, He's the center, He's the ultimate, He's the main part of your life experience. Now, if anyone had a really messed up identity, it was Jacob. Jacob, in our last story, I mean, think about it. He was dressing up like his brother in order to get the approval of his daddy. I mean, this guy really had a messed up self-image. He had a messed up identity. We talked about what you hear early and often. Have you ever thought about the fact that he was just named liar? His mom picked him up when he was a little kid and said, let's call him Jacob, which means deceiver. What you get put on you early and often can affect the course of your life and who you are. And this young man was given the name Liar. Well, last week we saw he deceived his father. He stole the blessing from his father and from Esau. And Esau, the only way Esau could comfort himself was thinking about and plotting and planning ways to kill Jacob. So Jacob got together with his mom, and she recommended that he flee to Haran, to his uncle's home, Laban, and that he would seek a wife there. And so now he's leaving this land of promise, and he's going on foot, leaving everything he has behind, and he's going to Laban in Haran, and he's on his way there when the sun sets and he lays down for the night. And we pick up in Genesis chapter 28, verse number 10. Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran, and he came to a certain place, and he stayed there that night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of that place, he put it under his head, and he lay down in that place to sleep. Now think about his predicament. He's leaving home, and he comes to a place that's just called a certain place. That means there's no name. There's no way to identify where this is. This is worse than Dimbo Holler, you know? I mean, this is just some place he came to, and the Bible says he took a stone and used a stone for a pillow to raise his head up off the ground. Now, why would you use a stone for a pillow? Because that's all you got. So he doesn't have a pack with him. He doesn't have a cloak he could fold up and use that for a pillow. There's nothing else around. All he could use to get his head off of the ground is a stone. So God, and this is what God often does, when he's trying to get you clear on your identity, he puts you in a situation where you don't have any of the things you're accustomed to leaning on. So he's separated from his dad, he's separated from his mother, he's separated from his brother, he's separated from all of his household and all of the stuff of his life. And here he is, broke, in the middle of nowhere, in a no-name place, with nothing to get his head off of the ground except for a stone. Verse 12. And he dreamed, and behold, there was a ladder set up on earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Now, the Hebrew word there for ladder is not a ladder like you and I think of, where one person can go up and another person go down, or a one-at-a-time kind of ladder, but it was more like the ziggurats that they found across Mesopotamia. We have an image, I believe, of a ziggurat. It's something like that. So many people at a time could fit on it, and there might have been, you know, a few angels. There might have been thousands of angels that are ascending and descending on this ladder. And the Bible says in his dream that the top of it reached all the way into heaven. And we see in verse 13, "Behold, the Lord stood above it." So at the top of the ziggurat was God. And he said, "I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and to your offspring. Your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east, and to the north and to the south. And in you and in your offspring shall all of the families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with you to keep you wherever you go. And I will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you." Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it." And he was afraid and said, "How awesome is this place! For this is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven." So God makes himself known to Jacob for the first time as he's alone, as he's helpless, as he's broke, and God says, "This is who I am." And it begins a pattern in Jacob's life that we're going to follow for the next few weeks that will ultimately lead to God saying, "You are so different than who you were when I met you that we're going to have to change your name from Jacob to Israel. Your identity has changed, and your name needs to reflect who the new you is." As you meet God, and as you focus on his identity, through that, God begins to alter and modify your identity. You've heard people say, "Well, I'm just trying to find myself." Don't try to find yourself. Try to find God. And God will find you. In the New Testament, Matthew, there was an occasion where Jesus sat down with Simon Peter, and he was talking to him. He was talking to all the disciples, and he said, "Who do men say that I am?" And they answered, "Well, some say you're Elijah, and others say you're Jeremiah or one of the prophets." And then Jesus asked probably one of the most important questions in all the Bible. He said, "But who do you say that I am?" See, there's a point in everybody's life, in every man and every woman's life, where you've got to answer that. Not who did your mother tell you I was, or what does your church teach you that I am, but you. Who do you say that I am? Peter, speaking up for the group, he said, "You are the Christ. You're God's anointed one. You're the Messiah. You're the Son of the living God." Jesus looks back at Peter, and he says to Peter, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah." Now notice his name. Simon Bar-Jonah means Simon, son of Jonah. His name was Simon. His father's name was Jonah. So he's Simon, son of Jonah. He said, "For flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." Now here's the, get this. Notice this. "And I tell you, you are Peter. Now that you focus on who I am and you understand who I am, let me tell you who you are. And who I created you to be. I didn't create you to be Simon. I created you to be the rock. Petros." When you focus on who he is, he begins to get in your business and start altering who you are. If you want to have the best view of you, you need to get God's view of you. He created you to accomplish something. He created you for his purpose. You say, "Well, I got to figure out what that is." No, you got to figure out who he is. Do you see it? As you focus on who he is, he begins to change and reveal who you were meant to be. Now, there's a few ways you can do this. You can look on the outside. That's the traditional approach. That just says basically culture names you. Culture tells you who you are and who you're meant to be. when you are in high school, some of these young people that are in high school, if they meet an adult, now you know this is true. This is a lot of times, if you meet an adult for the first time, the adult comes up to you and says, "What sport do you play?" Right? And then if you don't play a sport, you kind of feel like, well, you don't really have an identity. I remember when I was just not athletic. I just wasn't very coordinated. Hand-eye coordination just wasn't all there back in high school. And I remember all of my friends around me, they all played on the football team, and I always hung out with them, but I didn't play football. I had a kidney removed when I was a baby, and they just told me, man, if you get hit in that kidney, you're gone. Mom was like, you ain't playing. So I remember going to my friends and just and them being like, why don't you join the track team? They don't cut anybody. Why don't you join the track team? And I'm like, well, I'm not very fast. And they're like, well, do discus. I'm like, well, I can't throw it very far. And they said, well, nobody else throws it. So it doesn't matter how far you throw, you're the best. And so I got one of them little discs, and I learned how to spin, and I threw that discus. And I got me a letter to put on my letterman jacket, you know. And that gave me some identity, I felt like, you know. And so it just, you know, what do you do? Culture names you. They put you in a box, and they say, now this is who you are, and I'm going to put you right over here. You're a football player. You're in the band. You do this. You do that. Culture can name you. And then the modern approach is, don't listen to culture. Look inside yourself. Search within your own self. Find yourself. But Christianity says, not look outside, not look inside, but look up. And allow God to give you your truest self. Allow Him to set your identity. Tim Keller is a pastor that I listen to quite a bit. And if you don't listen to him, you should be. He's a great, great teacher of God's Word and helps you to understand a lot of things that I didn't understand before. And Keller was talking about a young lady at his first church. And she was depressed. She was a teenager, and she was she had a lot of anxiety, and she was very depressed. And her parents encouraged her to go meet with a pastor. And it was a small church. And so she went, she met with a pastor, and he was talking to her about, you know, all the things that are true about her if she's a believer in Christ. He said, you know, the Spirit lives within you. You are forgiven. Your sins are as far as the east is from the west. And he was just telling all of these true things about her. And she said, Pastor, I know I'm a Christian. But what good is that if a boy won't give you the time of day? And he said, Dr. Keller said, and that's when he realized that identity is kind of like a deck of cards. And there's several different aspects of who you are. And the main question is, what is the top card? So for this young lady, the top card was her relationship with the opposite gender. And did she have their attention? And did they want to be around her? And did they want to go out with her? That's how she... So everything else, that was the hub. That was the top card. And everything else rotated around that. So her Christianity was on the outside. She was a Christian, but it was over here in the center of her life was whether or not she could get the attention of boys. And he began to show her that, listen, what we have to do is move the place of God in your life to the top card. Do you see what I'm saying? See, for some of you, he's in the deck, but he's not the top card. And everything that you learn about walking with God, whether it's prayer or worship or Bible study, memorizing scripture, we don't do all of that stuff just because that's what we do. Some of us do, but that's not what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to be doing heart surgery as we sing. Heart surgery as we pray. Heart surgery as we read God's Word. All of those disciplines are to move the place of Christ from the bottom of the deck to the top of the deck. That's why it's not just a Sunday thing. That's why you've got to walk with Him on Monday and Tuesday. You've got to be in the Word on Wednesday and Thursday. You've got to be having Christian community and fellowship all throughout your week, because He will drift. And Satan doesn't really care where he's at on the deck, just as long as he's not the top card. He can't get Jesus out of your heart. He can't get him out of the deck, but he can get him off the top of the deck. And for many of you, I'm just being honest, I love you. I'm telling you, he's there. He's just not preeminent. And what God is saying to you today is, I've got to be the top card. I've got to be the center hub. I've got to be the sun in the solar system. I've got to be on the throne, not just in the throne room. I've got to be the main thing about you. The truest part of you is who you are in me. It's what God is saying. I was preaching at a men's conference several years ago, and my father's church was involved in it, and they invited my dad and several of the men from his church, and I was the speaker. And so, you know, those things can be kind of hokey sometimes. I mean, when you get a bunch of men in the room together, things can just get weird. They just do sometimes. And so they wanted to write all of our sins down on a sheet of paper and nail them to the cross. Well, I've done that about a jillion times. It's never helped me one bit. Well, let's burn them in the fire. That doesn't help either. You know, eventually you just got to repent and get right with God. But anyway, we did all of that stuff because that's what men like to do when they all get together. And so we did all of that stuff. And then we get in the room at night, and we had a group of men. There was about 10 in our little group, and they had us work through a series of questions. And one of the little exercises that they had us do was write down the man who has influenced you the most as a Christian. Looking back on it, I don't know who I wrote down. I may have wrote down Billy Graham or somebody, you know, that I just respected. Adrian Rogers, somebody. I don't know who it was. I wrote mine down, and everybody wrote theirs down. And my dad's in the room. He wrote his down. And they said, fold your paper up. They talked to us for a little bit. Then at the end of the night, they said, now we want to see who the influences were in your life. So they go around the room. I read mine. The guy beside me reads his. We go all the way around the room. It came to my dad. My dad was about 58 at the time, and dad was given to, you know, in those kind of settings, he could kind of get choked up. And so dad took the little paper, and he just laid it on the table. He didn't say anything. And I looked at the paper, and it had my name written. Now, that had a huge influence on me. My dad's in heaven now. And out of all of the memories, 40 years that I had with my father, that's the one I go back to the most. It shaped my identity. It shaped who I am. Now, I'm very thankful that card's in the deck. But as precious as that is to me, listen very closely, that card cannot be the top of the deck. If that is my ultimate identity, what my father thought of me, if that's my ultimate identity, even though it was wonderful, what if I do something that would disappoint him? What if he lived long enough and in his humanity he just said, you're a fool? Do you see, if that one great, wonderful card was the top card, it would have the capacity to crush me. So it's vitally important that whatever is on top, the top card has to be someone I can trust. Someone who will never let me down. Someone who will be honest with me and love me no matter what. It can't be who I am as a father. It can't be who I am as a husband. It can't even be who I am as a pastor. It's got to be who I am in Christ. And it's got to be that for you. Young lady, ma'am, sir, that's got to be preeminent in your life if you're ever to become who God created you to become. And that's what God is doing here in the life of our friend Jacob. How do you get him there? You focus on who he is, and then he changes the deck. He modifies you. By the end of the chapter, Jacob takes up the stone he had used as a pillow. He sets it up as a memorial altar, and he said, if God will see me through all of this stuff, I'm going to come back here and worship him, and I'm going to give him a tenth of everything I have. Now, up to that point, do you see how Jacob's life was known for taking, and now it's being changed into giving? It had been known as being a deceiver, and now he's going to be known as a worshiper of God. From this one encounter with God, God is changing him. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 3:18, and we all with unveiled face, beholding his glory, the glory of the Lord, as we behold his glory, we are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. And this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. As you seek his face, as you worship him, as you pray, as you make him the preeminent part of your day, give the first of your day to him, give the first of your week to him, give the first of your income to him, give the first of your service to him. And as you make him preeminent, beholding his face, seeking his face, you are changed. You're not changed from you know, being totally apart from God to being Billy Graham. You're changed from one degree to the next. You're a little closer to him than you were this time last year. You're a little closer to him than you were this time 5 years ago. And it's one degree at a time. But it always happens the same way, from beholding who he is, beholding his glory. Jesus referred to this encounter that Jacob had in the New Testament in John chapter 1. The Bible tells us that Philip had just been called to be a disciple, and Philip goes and gets his brother Nathanael. Now, there's a lot we don't know about Nathanael, so you have to use your imagination as you read the story. But Philip goes and says, I think I found the Messiah. Nathanael says, where is he from? He says, Nazareth. And he says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? And he said, just come and see. So Nathanael gets up and he goes with Philip and he's approaching Jesus. And the Bible says in verse 47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and he said to him, behold, indeed, an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. Now I want you to talk back to me for just a moment. What does Jacob mean? Deceiver, liar. And Israel means the Lord is victorious. In our story, in this series that we're in, we're going to see Jacob go from Jacob, the deceiver, to Israel, where God has victory. Now think about what Jesus is saying right here. What he is referring to this part of Scripture. Behold, an Israel in whom there is no Jacob. Over the course of your life, I'm going to make you more and more and more an Israel, less and less and less a Jacob. Remember what John the Baptist said? He must become more, I must become less. Nathanael says, how do you know me? And Jesus answered, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree. Now, we don't know what he was doing under the fig tree. Maybe he was meditating on the passage that we've read today. Where maybe he said something to God and said, God, I want to be less like Jacob, and I want to be more like Israel. And Jesus says, while you were there alone in your quiet time under the fig tree, I saw you. And he said, Rabbi, you're the Son of God. You're the King of Israel. And Jesus answered him, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, you believe me? You'll see greater things than these. Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see the heaven opened. And the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. He says, you haven't even gotten to the good part of the story yet. Because you're going to have your own encounter with me. And here's what you're going to realize. I'm the ziggurat. I'm the ladder. See, thousands of religions, and even some Christians, people that call themselves Christians, would say Jesus is a step. Jesus says, no, son, I'm the ladder. I'm the whole thing. I'm the only hope you've got of getting to the Father. I'm it. And as you focus like a laser, your life, your thinking, your philosophy, everything that you are, if you'll focus on me completely with everything you have, I will make you who my Father created you to be. Then and only then will you live the life that was meant for you. Let's pray. Honest question. If your life was described as a deck of cards, is Jesus in your deck? Follow-up question. Is he the top card? In this group of hundreds of people, there are some of you this morning that need to be real honest and say, you know, I try to pray occasionally. I remember when I was a college student calling myself a Christian. I remember the thought occurred to me, how do you call yourself a Christian when you never even, you don't even remember to pray? You go to church because your mom and dad make you go. How do you even claim that he's in the deck? And I had to get real honest and say, he's not. I know some stuff about him, but he's not really a part of my life. And then there's been times in my life where other things have gotten preeminence over him. Maybe it was being a dad or being a husband or being a pastor. Good things. Things I want in my deck, but they don't need to be the top card. Is he the top card in your life, sir? Oh, he's there. We know he's there, but is he the top card? You know, one of the ways that you cooperate with God and you just respond and you begin to move around the cards is to say, I'm going to humble myself before God, maybe by just going to an old-fashioned altar and kneeling down and saying, God, I'm just confessing and I want to say I'm sorry. I know that you've not had the preeminent spot in my life, and I want that to change. Maybe if you're unable to kneel, you want to just find a place on the front row to just sit down and humble yourself before God. You know, if he's the top card, whatever he says goes. And for some of you, he's speaking right now, and he's saying, you need to join this church. You need them, and they need you. And if he's the top card, game over. Business meeting adjourned. He speaks and you go if he's the top card. For others, maybe like the gentleman and lady earlier, you need to get baptized. If he's the top card, you need to come and let us know that this morning, today, at this invitation. There's a thousand and other things God's doing in different lives, and I couldn't begin to know them. But all that matters is that you hear and that you obey. I'm going to pray a short prayer. As I say amen, I want to invite you to come, that you make your mind up as I pray. Father, from the very back wall of this church all the way to the stage, God, we know you have dreams and plans and visions of what you want us to do and accomplish for your glory, who you want us to be. And if we fully knew it, it would probably scare us. But all we ask you today is to show us what is the next right thing for us to do in obedience to you. How can we know you more? And in response, Lord, you change us to who you want us to be. Speak to my family here, my church family. Speak to all of us, God, and show us how we can experience you to the fullest and in the process be changed. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand to our feet. You come as God draws.